Imagine that you could place a call to Uber Eats right now and have delivered on demand a meal that was going to be cooked to perfection, was the perfect temperature, was freshly prepared, tasted really good, had been developed at an extremely low cost, and was delivered with a smile, a rub on the back, and a big dose of affection. The theme of this year's UC Davis TED Talks is wholehearted. And I cannot think of a biological process more wholehearted than the way in which a mother prepares her milk for her offspring and the way that she delivers it. And I hope today to share with you some of the different insights by which this happens, all the way from the biological processes all across the planet. Because mammals, 6,500 different species, have evolved to use this common strategy of lactation and making milk in order to not only ensure that their individual infants survive, but whole species survive. And over the course of hundreds of millions of years, mammals evolved the strategy of basically having a mobile cafeteria that they had as they moved onto land in order to nourish their offspring. And this is essentially what has led to mammals being as successful as we are. Now, you don't have to be a TikTok influencer with a degree in dietetics to appreciate that milk is the perfect food and hence has to have a whole mixture of different ingredients in which to meet the needs of the infant. And these include water. Now, water is essential for life and, of course, forms the basis of a lot of milks. It's there for hydration, but also, of course, our infants don't even have teeth. And so, what better way to deliver the perfect meal than to actually deliver it in liquid form? But milk is so much more. It contains rich proteins and fats that are going to be deposited in the offspring's body as sources of developing muscle and fat storage. And they're going to take different carbohydrates that can be broken down as a form of energy to stay warm and also to nourish their brains. But mums also know that if you leave the milk out on the counter, it's going to spoil. And they know that in order to protect themselves, as well as to protect their offspring, that they should secrete different types of antimicrobial molecules in their milk, which they do. And they also know that their kids are walking petri dishes, prone to getting all sorts of diseases and infections. And so mums actually take antibodies from their circulation that they've been forming over their lifespan and accumulating, and they literally package them up into milk and deliver them to their offspring as a dose of immunity to provide their offspring with lifelong protection as they enter into the same environment. And infants are also going to want to move around and follow mum around, and so mum is going to share things like calcium and phosphorus to develop the skeleton of their offspring so that they can be big and strong. Now, all of this is happening because of the fact that epithelial cells within the specialized mammary gland that evolved from some simple structures such as sweat and scent glands are actually arranged as little clusters that are producing micro droplets of milk. And these cells are like little Amazon factories. And they're taking different ingredients from mum's circulation, things such as glucose and amino acids and fatty acids and immunoglobulins. And they're entering into the cells, these specialized cells, and being repackaged to a host of different types of molecules that are then ultimately being expressed in the form of new milk products. These are only found in the body, in the breast of the mother. So, for example, lactose, a sugar, is only produced in the mammary glands that not only is a source of energy, but also brings water into this complex fluid. The proteins that we know in cheese are there specifically to transport things such as calcium. And mums are also going to be transporting different types of fat molecules that are going to be a rich source of specified nutrition in order for supporting the growth of their individuals. But mums are also going to adapt to all of this process themselves. They want this to work. For those of you that have a gallon of milk in the fridge at home that you paid $4 for at the supermarket, it took 500 gallons of blood flowing through a dairy cow's udder to make that gallon of milk. And in fact, a dairy cow is going to move the equivalent of a backyard swimming pool of blood through her udder on a daily basis to produce the milk that she does. But these mothers are also going to be changing their digestive tract so that they can retain more nutrients from the diet that they're consuming. They're going to also be changing the biology of their kidneys and their liver in order to retain more calcium and to produce more glucose to support the milk that they have to deliver to their offspring. And they're also going to be doing things such as breaking down their own skeleton. They can lose up to 30% of their calcium stores and mobilize that into milk in order to make sure that their offspring does well and survives. If that's not wholehearted, I don't know what is. Now, if milk is perfect, which it is, then you might say, okay, then one size must fit all. Well, actually, that's where the fun begins, because in fact, if we take a global tour around this wonderful planet, we can find that not only is there a whole host of different types of milk produced around the planet, but also there's a lot of different strategies by which mothers deliver that milk in order to survive and to support their offspring. So for example, if we go down to Australia, whereas an environment where it's harsh and there's often droughts and floods, and we ask what kangaroos and wallabies do, they can actually support three offspring at once. They can have an undeveloped blastocyst in their reproductive tract waiting for the conditions to be ripe, but they can also then have just given birth to a baby joey about the size of a jelly belly that's migrated into the pouch, and it's going to be permanently attached to one specific nipple and drinking small amounts of a very specific type of milk that's tailored just for its developmental needs. But that joey also has an obnoxious brother or sister that's hopping around outside the patch, sticking its head in the pouch occasionally, looking for a drink. And it's going to be nursing from a completely different nipple that's going to be producing large volumes of a more dilute milk that's also tailored for its particular needs. So a fascinating example of how this species adapted to a very challenging environment through the process of lactation. If we also then go north and visit Santa Claus in the North Pole, we might come across some hooded seals. Now, their strategy is quite fascinating because, in fact, these mothers will go off and intensively feed before they give birth to accumulate as much fat in their bodies as they can. And then when they do give birth, they're only going to produce milk for 4 days. And their pups are going to basically be consuming a milk that's thick and creamy and almost like eating a stick of butter. And they're going to accumulate massive amounts of blubber because, of course, it's cold outside. And this would be equivalent to a 6-year-old human consuming about 100 Big Macs per day. If we then go a little bit to warmer waters and see what Cape fur seals do, there the mothers are actually leaving their pups on land, but they're going off to forage and eat fish as they do for a couple of days here or there, and they'll come back and then nurse their pups, and they'll do that for several months. But then, as time goes on, they have to go further and further afield on longer and longer fishing trips. And so eventually they have to go away for weeks on end. Now, that becomes a bit of a challenge if you're a lactating female, because in fact, normally the cells inside the mammary gland would respond by turning off their production of milk. But in fact, this species has evolved to not produce any lactose and hence doesn't accumulate large amounts of fluid. And so as a result, she's able to go away for these long periods, return back to land and feed her pups and not have negative consequences and then go back on another fishing trip. Across the way, if elephant seals are in the neighborhood, well, the male offspring there are becoming quite obnoxious. They're never happy with what mum has for them. So they're going to drink all of mum's milk, but because they want to become the dominant male within the colony, they're actually going to go across and push another pup aside and drink from another male just to become the biggest, strongest male in the colony, which is pretty fascinating. Back on land, we have a host of different herbivores that are grazing different types of environments, consuming indigestible plant material that wouldn't be of any use to any of us. And through the biology of the rumen and all of the microorganisms in the four-chambered stomach, they're able to take that indigestible plant material, break it down to the simplest of molecules, deliver it to the mammary glands, and reconvert it into the perfect food. Now, of course, this then is used for raising other infant animals that might be used in animal production systems for feeding humans. or producing dairy products. But in addition, one of the things that happens even here in our own backyard in California is we often use this process to take otherwise invaluable commodity byproducts that can then actually be broken down and resynthesized by ruminant animals into something as precious and valuable as milk, so you could all have your cappuccino before you came here today. Last but not least, as humans, we have evolved and developed very special lactation strategies that we've really only come to appreciate in the last couple of decades. Human milk is rich in particular types of sugars called oligosaccharides. And these oligosaccharides are specifically there to feed a particular species of beneficial bacteria called Bifidobacterium infantis that lives in the gut of human infants under ideal conditions. And this actually provides health benefits to the offspring and developmental advantages. So much so that, in fact, we now appreciate that supplementing a human baby in the neonatal intensive care unit with some human milk during that short spell can actually confer hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of health advantages during that infant's lifetime. So with all of that, now that you appreciate how perfect human, how perfect milk is, I ask you to join me in celebrating the gift that mothers give to their infants through milk. With Mother's Day coming up, whether it be on icebergs, whether it be on land, or whether it be in the living room, a mother keeps giving her gift of milk to her infants, and it's a gift that keeps on giving. Thank you.